On considère aujourd'hui que la situation des ressources et de la biodiversité
marine est alarmante. It is commonly thought nowadays that the situation of resources and marine biodiversity is alarming. FAO has been monitoring the evolution of marine resources being exploited and has shown that between 1974 and 2009, huge decrease of underexploited stocks had happened. They went from 40% to 12%, whereas the share of overexploited stocks had increased significantly from 10 to 30%. Whereas the stocks that were normally exploited had increased slightly from 50 to 57%. Now, the situation has serious economic consequences. First of all, through the profitability of fisheries. A world assessment of fisheries across the world showed an annual loss of $5 billion, whereas an optimal management of the same industry would have generated a $45 billion profit with a fishing effort divided by half. All of fisheries also receive subsidies, which are very costly for society and taxpayers with very limited efficacy. In France, it was shown that between 1960 and 2010, subsidies granted by the government to the fisheries were close to the value of fishes being landed. In 2003, across the world, the subsidies were close to $25 billion, i.e. 35% of the total value of fishes landed. It's absolutely essential now to set up a scientific approach based on an assessment of costs and advantages of the resources and biodiversity, but also assessing public policies for the management of fish resources and the setting up of environmental action on preservation, the reduction of entropic impacts on the ecosystem, and the creation of incentives encouraging more sustainable use of the resources. Marine resource economy and fishery economy is based on models, the bioeconomic models, notably, which are useful to manage fishing activities, but also useful in order to understand the dynamic of this sector, of this industry. The models here show fishing evolution as an interaction between a resource based on one or two stocks of fish, an economic sector with production means and labor, workforce, fishermen, and a context, an economic market and production costs and the legislative and institutional framework, which decide the management framework. Finally, management decisions are taken, and they have an impact on the resource being exploited, but also on the economic sector and the results. Gordon Schaeffer's model presented on this graph is a very good example of the bioeconomic approach. On the horizontal axis, we see the fishing effort, based on all of the hardware and human resources used to catch fish. And the two curves in the graph show the evolution of income based on the fishing effort, the blue curve, and evolution of wealth created by fishing, i.e. profit. We can see that when fishing effort increases, two optimum points are reachable, a biologic optimum and an economic optimum. The biologic optimum corresponds to the maximum production in terms of value, whereas the economic optimum corresponds to the maximum profit. In order to achieve maximum profit, the fishing effort must be lower than the one that will achieve maximum production. It is also thought that if the fishing effort is not managed or regulated, fisheries will tend to continue developing spontaneously until they reach the free access equilibrium point when profit equals cost. In other words, nobody earns a living. The fishery is no longer going to produce wealth for society. Obviously, this is not what we are trying to achieve for society, because first of all, it means that we are overfishing. We produce more fish than we could produce with less ships. And also, economically speaking, this is overfishing. We are not creating any wealth, whereas we could have created wealth for society if we had decreased the fishing effort. So in order to deal with the over-exploitation situation in fisheries, several management tools have been suggested. First of all, tools based on better monitoring of production means. Production means can be controlled physically, directly, with fishing licenses or fishing permits in order to limit the number of authorized fishing units. But there can also be an indirect physical control, acting on the specifications of the ships rather than their number, and by implementing spatial closure or seasonal closure of fishing campaigns. We can also act on production means by controlling their cost by introducing fishing fees that will be combined with the fishing permit, so every fishing unit must pay for a fishing fee, and also by introducing taxes or subsidies on the inputs used by fishing units. Controlling production means physical limitations being imposed on the number of catches. Here we have the TAC, total admissible catches, the maximum number of fishes that a fishery cannot exceed for a given year. This is what is currently applied in Europe. Once defined, the TAC can be divided in individual quotas divided among the fishermen. And we can also define the legal size of the catches, and we can limit accessory catches that happen during fishing. Finally, we can act on production prices by regulating market, but apart from subsidized prices for some species, these last tools are not very often used. Marine environment economy targets a much wider perspective than the economy of fisheries. One needs to understand the real value of marine ecosystems and biodiversity by assessing their economic value. Then it will be necessary to correct the methods or suggest new economic methods to complement the standard economic methods, which are not well adapted in the absence of market prices or in the presence of imperfections on the market prices on the market. Assessing the value of marine ecosystems means that we also have to assess the ecosystemic services, marine ecosystemic services, i.e. the trade and non-trade services provided by ecosystems to society and contributing to economic and social well-being. This is an anthropocentric approach. We must distinguish these services from the ecologic functions performed by ecosystems. The Millennium Ecosystem Assessment performed in the early 2000s provided a general framework for systemic analysis with a type of services. So we have ecosystemic services for supply, food and raw materials extracted from ecosystems, ecosystemic services for regulation through climatic regulation, pollution, erosion control, cultural ecosystemic services, recreational activities, or aesthetic or spiritual. The spiritual dimension may be involved. And finally, support ecosystemic services such as primary production in the ecosystem and recycling of nutrients. The various ecosystemic services contribute to the elements which constitute the population's economic and social well-being through increased safety, support provided to health or social relations.
En 1997,
a pioneer work was conducted in this field by Costanza et al. In a paper published in Nature.
D'un des premiers essais d'évaluation.
We were looking at one of the very first attempts to assess globally the value of ecosystemic services for all of the present biomes across the planet. The value of ecosystemic services was assessed and then matched with the surface unit. And this led to the map you are being shown. Say we focus on marine ecosystems, we can see that the value of marine ecosystems is $21 billion, or 64% of the world ecosystemic services. Within marine ecosystemic services, coastal ecosystems are in the dominating position because they provide 59% of marine ecosystemic services. But support ecosystemic services are the most important through primary production of ecosystems.
Pour conclure, to conclude, il faut rappeler quel est le concept principal
I'd like to remind you of the main concept implemented by economists in order to assess ecosystems. We're talking about the total economic value,
qui est égal à la somme,
which is equal to the sum
marchand,
of use value, trade and non-trade. Non-trade users are studied with conventional tools reserved to market economies. Adding to that, non-trade values and the intrinsic value for the various ecosystem components. Environmental economy has produced some methods in order to obviate for the difficulty to assess non-trade ecosystemic services. These methods are well known. And nowadays, for marine ecosystems, we need to use them in a more systematic way, and we need to make an effort to adjust those methods to the specific features of the ecosystems.